Hello, humans. Good evening, Dreef. How is everyone? Happy Friday. Is this working? Is this thing working? Yes. Is this working? I'll just tap everything.
Drift is connected to chat at 56k baud. Edgybat has entered chat.
Edgybat, I know you're there. No, I'm joking. I'm joking. Hey, everybody. Welcome. Hope everybody's had a fantastic week.
Pew, 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 pew.
Hey, hey. Hey, hey. Today, we're going to be continuing with the Gundam Double Zeta Resin Conversion Kit from Fortune Meow Studios. I quickly slapped together the double whammo blammo cannon. I can't remember what it's called. Double beam rifle cannon, I think it's called, before the stream. This is a really simple thing to put together. And during the course of it, I lost a piece. See how you can see through there? That little hole there is gone. But it doesn't matter, because you know what? These parts, don't need them anyway. We use these bits. So it's okay. It's okay that we lost parts. I didn't really lose parts. They're in the room. Nothing's ever lost in here. It just gets kind of Hotel California. Yeah. So I thought we would maybe take the first sort of stab at putting this piece together. They're just misplaced. Because this thing actually goes together with these kick-ass, these shitty, like, what even is that? It's a tube. Come on, Bandai, you can do better. They get replaced with these doodads that look like this when they're done. Yeah. And it goes kind of from being just pew-pew to, you know, pew-pew. Like that. And you go in there. And you go here. Only imagine they're straight. anyway, so yeah, perfect. Looks kind of like a Y-wing. No, it's okay. It's over. I think it's over there somewhere. So I'll find it. I'll find it. It's okay. So do you keep all the stuff that's getting replaced for scratch building or anything, or just trash them? No, I do keep them. I keep all these bits. Because they do come in handy. I have a giant bucket of stuff that I think might come in handy for kit bashing, scratch building. Absolutely. Little tiny soap bottles and shampoo things and you know, those Cartier tanks for whipped cream canisters. I've got dozens and dozens of those, because they just, one day, they'll be the perfect tanks for cylinders for something. But yeah, generally I just keep all the parts. Because of your whip it habit. Are whippets the same thing down in the States? Whippets up here are like, it's like a cookie with a marshmallow coating on top of it and a jam within it. Or no, chocolate. And then chocolate over the whole thing. That's a whippet up here. Or do you mean the dogs? Because I don't know what you'd use those canisters on with a dog. Definitely not the same thing. Okay, well, good to know. Yeah, whippets are like a marshmallow chocolatey cookie in Canada. Perfect as it is, ship it. Yes. Anaheim Industries, man. They were never very high for... They were never very much for high standards, right? Just get it out the door. It's fine. They can work around that. We'll fix that with an update. But anyway, and then the other thing that we're going to be doing is... I'm going to disable that. The other thing that we're going to be doing is we're going to be just putting some decals on the arms, I think. Some nice relaxing ASMR decal application on the arms. Whippets are using those whipped cream canisters to get high off nitrous. Oh! I had no idea. Well, here, let me give you a little tour. That's a whippet in Canada. Yeah. And they've been made with real chocolate since 1927. Before that, no one's really sure what the fuck they were made from. But yeah. After that, definitely chocolate. One time at a nightclub in New York City, I went to the bathroom and the girl next to me dropped her purse. And all these whippets fell out all over the floor. Like, these whippets or the nitrous canisters? I'm confused now. Looks sort of like a moon pie. You see, we don't have moon pies here. The canisters, yeah. Clanking all over the place. Anyway, so when you said whippet, that's what I thought of, was a whippet. Yeah, the girl was scrambling to eat them all up. You know, or alternatively, a bunch of these fell out all over the floor. That would have been strange as well. If that had happened, perhaps it was you who was doing the whippets. Now, though, I will say this, though. All right, I feel as though I have to protect... I have to protect my honor here, because I've been accused of being a hunt and peck typist, which is hurtful. And I will not stand for that, madam. So... What I will say is this, is I have a small hobby where wait for it here. collect these things. All right. And you know, all you youngins with your fancy cherry MX blues and reds might not comprehend just what a keyboard like this does to your fingers. This is an Olivetti Lettera 32. It's a classic portable typewriter. Many a famous author has used one of these. I can't remember off the top of my head which ones, but definitely one of the popular ones. Made in Italy. Fully portable. Comes in a lovely case with a beautiful racing stripe down the center. You put this stuff in it called paper. And you remove the lock. This is indeed Smash Your Fingers with Corvus. Friday Night Smash. Friday Night Finger Smash with Corvus. But you see, here's what I have to work with, right? Like, try touch typing with one of these, okay? As somebody who grew up with, you know, Mavis Beacon's typing tutor on your IBM keyboard, right? Yeah. Hey, Huge is Plastic. How are you? I literally snorted. So yeah, this is one of my hobbies, is portable typewriters. Hey, and this is what's great about them too, right? Look at these. Fraction keys. Remember when you needed fractions for things? Weird math things, yeah. Fractions. Now I live in a country that doesn't even use a penny anymore. Anyway, so that's what I had going for. This is what I do. This is one of the things I do with my time, is I rehabilitate these old typewriters. And I'm just used to hunting and pecking on them, because it's almost impossible to touch type on them unless you have adamantium fingers. I do indeed write on them, yes. Where's the whiskey glass? Well, you know, I've been trying to cut back. But wait, there's more. Slick case, racing stripe, super fast.
Here's Corvus.
This one you'll especially like this one. This one is like the dumbest typewriter ever made. But it had the most hilarious advertising campaign, which I will try to find. I'll try to find some YouTube videos of this. This is the Olivetti Valentine, made by the same company that made that Sirius typewriter I just showed you. It comes in a plastic bucket for some reason, as a traveling case. Yeah, wow. So, this one was designed by a famous Italian designer whose name I forget. I should have prepared for this more than I did. It roughly has the same innards as what I just showed you. But no, it wasn't Mr. Valentine. It was someone else. I could look it up. But it's also a really fun one. Very, very similar in terms of how it works. But you know, the problem with it is it's kind of a joke. Like there's a lot of plastic in it, so it's a bit more, it's not as solid feeling. But it's absolutely hilarious looking. Like you can see here, there's no gap. This is loose, so I need to fix that, but. It's just a silly typewriter. See? It's a silly typewriter. It's very pretty. It's one of those ones that a lot of collectors are that's in high demand. Has these neat little yellow caps, little screws, little screw cap things to hold the ribbons on. It's all phenolic, I think. Well, those are phenolic. I think the rest of it is an ABS plastic of some kind. But it's a very nice typewriter, and I'm proud to have that one. That's the Valentine. Secretary is still probably, you know what, I don't know for dads. You see, this is the kind of thing that would have like really been this is shit to type on for a long period of time. It's all about the looks. But let me find, when I say restore these, I try to buy ones that are very much in working condition, and if I need to bend a few parts, I'm okay with that, but I try not to take them all apart. You know, but the thing is, they're usually built like tanks, and I try to stick with ones that are kind of, that aren't like super ancient. I don't have any, for example, with, you know, those round button keys, the metal and black keys, that you see on the older ones. But this is a fun one. I really like the Valentine. It's just a pretty looking thing. It has these rabbit ears that come out the back like this. The other one had these too, as a paper holder. And I'll show you one more after this. I'll show you my favorite, the best typewriter ever made, in my opinion. The best portable typewriter ever made. But before I do that, let me just show you. It's show and tell night, by the way. Did I mention that? Before I do that, though, let me just find some of the Valentine ads, because they are absolutely unbelievable. I would think a splash of color amongst the browns and grays of older offices would be, it would have been, yeah, but then they would have to type on it and realize this is awful. Give me back my Olympia. Valentine's Day. There are some super trippy old Olivetti ads. Ettore Sottas is the name of the designer. I might not be able to find it. If I can't find it, I'll just post them later on in Discord. For me, my YouTube foo is not working as well as I thought it would. Let me just try this 60s Olivetti ad. Okay, no, this is getting me closer here. Olivetti advertisement, Valentine. No. I'll find them and post them in Discord. We'll do that. They're ridiculous. All right. Change the load. Instead of working through six calculations. True. We were like that with the C310H. Those of us that learned slip loading slide rule. Right. All right, last but not least. This is the one I call Minty Fresh. He has a name. This is the Hermes 3000. Swiss, probably the greatest portable typewriter ever made. This is an early model of it. Aficionados would say the best Hermes 3000s are the later ones that are more angular, but I like the curvy ones. Like me some curves. So, yeah, but this one, if I can remember where the carriage lock is, there we go. No, that's locked. There we go. Rite Aid, welcome. Yeah, no. I was accused of being a hunt and peck typist, and so I'm just explaining why I tend to hunt and peck, because I have a penchant for old portable typewriters, which sort of necessitate hunting and pecking to a degree, unless you have titanium fingers, which I don't. This one is sort of the pinnacle of typewriter design. This is a 20-minute tangent. You're lucky. Usually they're longer. The Hermes 3000 has like automatic tabs. You know, you can set your own tabs up with it. So, you know, you can space to here, set a tab, space to here, set a tab, etc. If I remember how to use it. Yeah, see? Tabs. There are my tabs. And then It also has like four ribbon levels, as well as a ghost for whiteout. This is the key pressure, which really is like hard, really fucking hard, unbelievably fucking hard, impossible kind of thing. That's how typewriters work. You'll note that there's no number one, very common. You use the I. No, you don't. You use the L, dum-dum. Right? But, yeah, this is my favorite typewriter ever. If I could only type on it. I'm out of practice. Anyway, Hermes 3000, ladies and gentlemen. Has some really neat features, like the margin. There's a little red tape that's actually in this, if you can see up close. Probably can't see it, but like over here, there's a little red tape right there that actually slides. It's a ribbon that slides back and forth, and you can actually set the margins, and it tells you where the margins are. I think there might be some resin conversion kits for these, but they're really rare. And it's really just these knobs. That's all that gets replaced. Anyway. Enough of this madness. Let's get back to robots. I forgot where I put the case. Just lock this. There we go. The typewriter is essentially integrated into the travel case, which is really cool. Anyway, there you have it. Call me a hunting pack typist, I'll tell you. I'll tell you what. So, as I was saying earlier, I think what we'll do is we'll do a little bit of work on this guy. Maybe do some taping and painting on here. And then we'll switch over to doing some decals. You're most welcome, Etchybat. The real reality is I just suck at typing. The real reality. I said that. The real reality is... The realest of real realities is that I am a touch typist. I'm not a touch typist, is what I'm trying to say. Apparently, I hunt and peck at speaking as well. But, You type on those old keyboards and you kind of just get into the habit of doing this because you just can't, you know, the throw on the keys is like a centimeter and a half on some of them. So, and not only that, but the keyboard angle, I don't know if you noticed on those old typewriters, but it's like having this, it's like having your keyboard like this, right? So it's, you know, it's just hard. Anyway, for that, you go and feed, enjoy. So we need to take this. So I did build this out, as I was saying earlier. It has these silly little shit guns on the sides, like this. And we're gonna replace those with these better ones that are made out of these parts. Which I did assemble earlier. They look something like this. For the sides. Way more detail. That compared to that. Womp womp. Boring. And then this piece... here, this sort of, I guess it's supposed to be some kind of camera. There's a sticker that goes there that I didn't put on. That gets replaced with this piece, which I think fits in there. So we do have to crack this back open. And put that piece in there in lieu of this. So let's just disassemble this quickly. Do I have any spudgers around? No. Hopefully nothing will break. Well, I hope everybody's had a great week. I am very thankful that this week is over. It's been very busy for me at work. Bad. I hope your vacation has gone as well as you would have expected. So does that just sit in there? I think it does. So we just have to build this without this piece in at all. And then we'll strip it apart and do some painting. Yeah, so it's really just that we don't need. I'm just sad the week is over and I have to go back to work next week. But yes, it was good to check out for a few days. Awesome. Yeah, so that goes in there. Yeah, that's always the problem with vacations is they have to end, sadly. A lot of the parts on this kind of move, but it's because it's a, this is a transforming kit, right? Not after the resin conversion, but it is to begin with a transforming kit, the standard one. The non-resin conversion is what I'm trying to say. That all goes bye-bye after the resin conversion. The stupidest thing, like the double Zeta. Hey, D Shenlong, how are you? Welcome. Good to see you. Hope you've had a great week. The stupid thing about the Gundam double Zeta is there's like three pilots in it, and they're just in the stupidest places. Like if this was you know in canon the actual gun, there would be a pilot dude sitting upside down, facing backwards in this gun. Like, why? What's the logic there? Right? Like, that's really weird, don't you think? Wouldn't that be uncomfortable? And I mean, there's the one that's in the core fighter that's inside of it, but then this guy gets screwed. He's like, you know, like I hope they supply him with some magazines or something, because he's not only is he upside down, but he doesn't even get to watch what they're shooting, you know? He's literally in the gun, and he can't watch what it's shooting at, because he's facing backwards. Stupid. So these guys will go here. I'm not sure what the best way of attaching that is. I'll probably just epoxy that in there. I'm not going to do a whole lot, I think, with this tonight. I think I'll just do some of the masking on these side pieces. And then off stream, I'll do... I have to prime all these parts and get them done. But I won't bore you with that. Instead, I'll bore you with archaic writing instruments from the 50s and 60s. All right. So with these parts, we are going to paint them roughly like this. So we need some blue. Oh, I see, that folds down. Okay. So these end pieces are pretty much all one solid color with the exception of the orange stripe that's in there. So we'll have to mask that out. Ugh, that sucks. That's really thin. Greatest Jay Chan, how are you? I'm fine, thank you. Things are going very well. Just continuing work on the Gundam Double Zeta, which I haven't actually shown yet. But we're just working on the double beam cannon, I think it's called. Yeah, it is going to be tedious. But I should be able to do it. I should be able to do it just with a really, really thin strip. We'll just inverse paint that. So what we'll do is we will paint it orange, get it nice and deep in that crack, and then probably do both these rings, that one and that one, in orange, and then we'll just mask off the orange and then paint the whole thing gray. Probably the easiest approach with that. Let me actually get the guy. Hold on a moment. Nice and deep in that crack. I said it. Anyway, that's basically where we're at with them. Got all the legs done, torso done. We've got the head finished. This piece comes off, and we did in a past stream install a LED in there. I turned the camera off. Sorry about that. That's better. So there is a green LED in there, obviously. I think it looks pretty green on camera. It overexposes, right, lights, so it tends to look a little whiter on what you guys are seeing than what I'm seeing. It really just looks like a really nice crisp green. But yeah, you know, they gave me that clear piece of resin, so I sort of had to. And I just put it in the core fighter, so the center, the chest of this thing is basically the core fighter, and I have no intention of ever taking this apart once it's put together, and so I basically just ran wires down into the cockpit of the core fighter from batteries that are up in the back of the head, and I put the switch behind this breastplate that just sort of slides in on a couple of pins like that. And then I've been also working on the arms. get all these pieces out. Because we're really close, actually, everybody. We're really quite close to the end of this project. Like, maybe... I know, Etchy's gonna say, lol, he lies. But we are basically at the point where all I really need to do, what I have left to do is just get the arms and the weapon done. And the arms are finished. I've officially finished all the panel lining. They've all been assembled. These are the big shoulder pieces. The arms proper are done. They've been epoxied and put together. I haven't even cut the hands out yet, so don't ask me about the hands, but that is but a trifle doing the hands. So those are finished. These pieces are done that go on the sides. Like that. And then these great big wing pieces attach in there. Right? And then this is up here. Like this. Got that. Yeah, that's right. It's like that and like that. Anyway, you get the idea. So they're done. It's just a matter of kind of doing these last little bits and pieces and getting it assembled. And then everything, most of this guy has been hit with a matte coat. Thank you, Greatest Champ. Much appreciated. And at this point, it's really just doing the, it's finishing the arms and getting the decals on them. There's some big complicated decals that I probably won't do on stream because, you know, you do stuff on stream and you have a much higher probability of fucking stuff up while you're watching chat and everything. So there's some very large decals I'll probably do on the off stream one. But yeah, the shoulders. I can probably get these kind of assembled. Hopefully it won't fall apart. I'm not going to push them right in, but just so you have an idea of what it looks like. And then there are these little doodads here. I don't know what they are, but they sit in between. And then, oh, of course, I'm not even showing some of you newcomers. There's a backpack. I almost forgot that, but there's this huge backpack that goes on the back of this. Back here. Yeah, jets. They're basically jets. There's these wings that's come out the side, as well as launchers. Get it more in the light for you to see the detail on that. Greatest Chan, I don't know if you you've seen that one. And then there's some white pieces that stick up out of here. They're over there somewhere. So yeah, this goes on the back of it. There's this red this piece here. It pins through there. Yeah, all in all, this has been a really fun resin conversion to do. Dishan, just so you know, you mentioned you'd done some Gunpla. This is actually, what's called a resin conversion kit. So it's a base model Gunpla of the Gundam Double Zeta kit, which is a pretty fancy kit to begin with. But then with resin conversions, you get replacement parts. So like these standard pieces are replaced with much more detailed resin parts. Yeah. Well, just so you kind of get it as far as when we talk about resin conversions, that's what this is. And these are basically just higher detailed pieces that require a little more work. Yeah. Anyway, I'll leave it to you guys. What should we do? Should we paint? Should we paint or should we do decals? Painting means watching me tape stuff, which most of you are probably pretty familiar with. Just one moment while I attend to that. Painting. All right. We'll go with painting. Di Shenlong has spoken. Just looking at this, figuring out how to start this best. Let's go with more tape. Okay, let's do these pieces, I think. Let's start with these. Drift, blowing some channel points. I hope it was as good for you as it was for me. Oh, man. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Too kind, Drift. Too kind. Gifting Di Shenlong that 1 month subscription. Much appreciated, my friend. You are a very generous and kind soul. Thank you. Thank you. That's why you got an error. That blew my eardrums out, too. Hey, Greatest Chan. Thanks for dropping by. Good to see you again. Good to hear from you. Keep on building, my friend. I'll take 2 months, Twitch. Don't be stingy on me. Awesome. D Shen Long, welcome. Welcome to the family. Welcome to this band of degenerates. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to tape this. I think what we'll do is we're going to paint this completely white. And then we're going to tape off. I don't know anymore. No, we're going to go the other way, I think. We're going to tape it. We're going to paint it the dark gray. I'm going to use the darkest of my grays for this. And then we'll tape it and cut in the white. Some really shitty panel lines on this side. Which I really should scribe out a little more, but I don't think I will because I'm lazy. And you know what, everybody? I kind of want to start building that, kind of want to start building the schnabel gun. It'll be okay. So let's see here if we have this thing working. Does my spray booth camera work?
It does indeed.
Okay. So let's just get this shit out of the way. And let's paint. Let's get some stakes. All right. You guys can see that okay? That's good. Turn on some fans. As always, Mr. Color Rapid. We'll go with Mr. Color German Gray. Now, I keep forgetting I've pre-thinned this. I'm just trying to use up the last of my my paint here in this jar. So I'm just going to put this thinner back. Give this a good shake. Give it a good mix. Probably won't have enough paint, but that's okay. I have another jar. least I think I have another jar. All right, bear with me here. Wouldn't that be funny if I didn't actually have the paint that I need? So weird. I'm sure I had more German gray. It's not a big deal if I don't. We can just move on to something else. But how peculiar. If only I was organized. I may have simply confused gray for German gray.
Look, everyone, read your manga. Dreamcatcher Skye just entered Corvus's chat. Welcome to the stream, Dreamcatcher Senpai.
Dreamcatcher, your words are hurtful. Rare full light background to see all your shelves shot. Organization is overrated because I just don't think I have it. I thought this was one, but it isn't. You know, I was glancing over at this one and I thought, okay, I've got more of it, I'm good. But it's not. It's not the same. Zing, zing. All right, well, that's okay because what we can do is we can probably just get away with using gray. Or can we? Or do we just do something else? Let's just do the decals. Sorry, folks. Sorry, D. Shenlong. You're the one who voted to paint. But that requires paint. Perplexing. Oh well, onward and upward. Let me just clean my brush out. Very strange. I think I just used it all. Oh well. Wait a minute. I've got an idea. What if we changed it? No, we shouldn't do that. We really shouldn't do that. Use invisible paint. We'll just pretend airbrush it. If only your paints weren't in a box. Yeah. So hurtful. Paintless paint stream. Use invisible paint. Paint with your mind. Can you paint with all the colors of the wind? Bat. This is my Renfair version. I left it in for fun.
More tape for the tape god, and more resin for the resin throne. More screws for the screws, Lord, and more paint for the paint king. Airbrush, a spray booth we bust, and more blades for the scalpel too. Panel line, we will transcend time, and more tape for the tape. I need resin kits for my backlog here on my shelf. They'll sit waiting for a time, my friends, a time in my stream that they'll fit. Heels, we need mega heels to get Naganode right here in the fields. I mean, really, friends, I'm not sure why the hell I'm in Renfair at all.
I think Unpredictable just said I should be in it, and I panicked. I panicked and I said, fine, I'll do it. I'll do Renfair.
But why?
More tape for the tape god, and more resin for the resin. More screws for the screws, Lord, and more paint for the paint queen.
More tape for the tape god.
More tape.
And you know what? I won that argument too with the maple syrup, because I haven't seen or heard from Unpredictable since Renfair. She's cowering behind her Vermont maple syrup superiorness. Or should I say false superiorness? Yeah, we had a Renfair, a streamer's Renfair that Unpredictable and Etchy and Jexy organized, and it was fun. It was a lot of fun. But I did a special Renfair version of the Tape God for that, and I thought I'll leave it in case somebody wants to have a throwback. Was that a reference to Don't Tease Me, Miss Nagano? Etchy is solely responsible for bringing the whole thing together. I can't take any credit for organizing that thing. I was just a spreadsheet and a flowchart nerd. I know. But you know, credit where credit is undue, is what I say. All I know is Renfair would never have happened if it weren't for me. I'm just saying that. Unpredictable's not here, right? What can she say? Unpredictable, are you here? Too funny. All right. We're going to do some decals. Because this dum-dum didn't get paint. Title is Don't Tease Me, Miss Nagatoro. Got my names crossed. Yeah. There was a reference to Nagano, the Five Star Stories designer and writer. Who really, really likes his heels on his mecha. So let's start big with this one here. Let's get this guy done. Too much sugar? Yeah, you know what? I'll be honest with you. I don't actually have a lot of maple syrup. That shit'll kill you. So yeah, if anyone's working on anything they want to share, please feel free to post pics in chat. Oh, Dreamcatcher, A2 Brute. A2. And what's local stuff? To Dreamcatcher. It's gonna go right there. Where did I put it? There it is. Eastern Ohio. What? Okay. Yeah. No. 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 Back. Thank you, Mad Titan. Nah, honestly, support local. Support local. But when you have important guests over and you need to bust the waffles out, that's when you pull out the good stuff from Quebec. Not quite. So I tend to just soak the decals directly in the microset, the microscale solution industries microset, rather than soaking them in water and putting microset on the piece and then all that nonsense. I just use the microset like it's water. Position it carefully. And good Lord, I have a single Q-tip left. It's a cursed stream, everyone. I buy all my honey from the Amish. Don't get much more local than that. My local honey is yo. I do actually, I don't believe that there's a single best place to get honey. Support your local apiaries for sure, because those apiaries support your local crops. We have a lot of local honey up here too, and it is such an enormous difference in quality from just store-bought honey. Absolutely. Beehive next door, pretty darn local. I've never tried honey with a comb till I tried the local stuff, so good. But the American way of Deckles. I'll say it both. I'll say it either way. When it comes to Deckles and decals, I swing both ways. I'm too afraid of biting into a larva to comb. Dream, you just gotta keep chewing. You just gotta keep chewing. I'm not the curse bringer. That's awesome. Bees naturally separate their brood comb from their honeycomb. Yes, that is true. That is true. They'll put in this. Okay, yeah. Neighbor had a beehive in one of his trees, and the bee guy who took it gave us fresh honey from it. Nice. That's pretty cool. All right. Now it looks like we got one of these. Let's use these ones. Fiance is a state certified journeyman beekeeper, and she's taught me a lot. So how many hives do you guys have, Matt? I work with a lady who is really into it. Like, really into it. Like, so she's so into it, you generally do not want to bring it up. If you have work to do. She has 6 hives right now. We have about 16 gallons of honey waiting to be bottled. Wow. That is a lot of honey. God, I hope you like honey. Oh, you must sell it. I mean, 16 gallons of honey. Lord. Did you know honey literally never corrupts? It just crystallizes. I heard something about some science people who discovered really old honey that was still safe to eat in tombs. Yeah, wasn't it Egyptians? Didn't they find honey in Egyptian tombs? She sells it at the city farmers market. Okay, that makes sense. Let's just get this one on while we have this deckle cut out. I like honey, but I tend to stay away from sugary things. Because they tend to make me what's that expression? Fat. They make me fat. Applying decals is either cathartic or boring as fuck, depending on who you are, how you feel. I'm kind of in the middle, somewhere in the middle. My memory of the article is too vague to know if it was the Egyptians. Yeah, I think they found honey and I think grains of rice as well. Or seeds of some kind that they were able to still germinate. Yeah, I mean, it's a good idea in general. It's not to have too much sugar. Alright, so let's now get this other side done, which is this AUGE one. This guy here. I'm somewhere in the middle too. I get tired of stickers after a while, but water and dry applies are rewarding because they actually look pretty good afterwards. Yeah, you really can't beat the aesthetic of decals over stickers, that's for sure. They are far superior. In fact, I would say with stickers, I've said it on stream before, I am almost embarrassed to say I've never actually done a high grade. I've never done a kit that had stickers. Really. Because while I am doing a Gunpla build right now, I'm not really a Gunpla streamer, for lack of a better expression. I do resin kits, right? Well, you know, the last one we did prior to this, the Double Zeta, was a 5-star stories Machine Messiah AUGE. And before that, I was working on a Waldo from Industria Mechanica, which is a little sci-fi tugboat IP from Ian McHugh. which I will get back to eventually, but it was a bit too technical of a build for this medium. Required me to really concentrate, and I found that it I was making a lot of blunders that were not good blunders to make. So I decided to move on to the Machine Messiah, take a little break from that. You know, just take a little tiny break from this this kit to and do a 200 piece resin kit. Just a little break. There, that looks pretty awesome. I don't think I'll ever be able to quit chocolate outright, but I'm fairly confident I can get myself down to the point where it's a once-in-a-while treat. Yeah, my wife is the same way. My wife is the same way. She doesn't really do a lot of sugar, but she'd stab you before giving up chocolate. To be fair, processed and natural sugars are chemically identical. It's just that the sugars in processed products tend to be in higher quantities because they want an intense flavor. Glucose and sucrose and fructose and glucose and sucrose and fructose, yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, they're carbohydrates, right? That's what they are. So, the little paper tags that are on the backs of the decals, what I like doing is just throwing them on the floor in here so they get stuck to my socks, and then I track them all through the house, and it reminds everybody in the house that I build Gundam and I put on decals and I'm a hobbyist. It's my little way of marking my territory. Okay, now gonna put a couple little tiny pieces down in these bottom corners, little tiny guys. Let's find some. Here we go. These will work. High sugar content in junk food is what's causing diabetes and heart disease. That's right. That's right. Watch out. You know, imagine that ranger. Imagine that ranger character picking one up, looking at it, smelling it. It's fresh. We're in Corvus territory. Beware. This kit is a little reminiscent of Verkaw. Well, it is a Verkaw. Like, the base kit is a Verkaw. I'm not really using a lot of the Verkaw decals, but the, you know, the Verkaw kits are kind of renowned for having, like, just a zillion tiny, 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 tiny little decals to put all over the place. And they give you, in the resin conversion, they give you this other sheet, which has an equal number. I'm not even going to use anywhere near as many of the as this, but it's just funny. This is from Double Zeta. Zeta Zeta. Gundam Double Zeta. And the faction is the AUGE. I had a hard time with Double Zeta. The anime. Took a really long time to get in, to get kind of going. I don't know if there's anyone else in there in chat who's watched it. But it's one of those early ones where there's it's a big commitment. There's a lot of episodes. And I know you probably wouldn't, you probably don't do dubs, Dreamcatcher. But, hang on, let me just get this decal on. Oh, you do? Okay. I wasn't sure. I know you're very much an enthusiast of manga and anime, and I wasn't sure if you... I tend to do them if I'm working. I'll watch dubs. I'll watch with dubs on, so I don't have to be reading constantly, right? It can be doing something else. But for Double Zeta, there is no dub. It's kind of got a funny backstory where there apparently was a dub, an English dub at one point, that was so unbelievably terrible. It was so bad. Sunrise just erased it from the face of the earth. It aired once, I think, on a Korean TV with the English dub. And they... You go to the Wikipedia page about it, and it's absolutely hilarious to read. Like, it must have just been so bad that Sunrise essentially just put it somewhere. They probably erased it, but they have literally come out and said, that will never be released, ever. Double Zeta, the Shenlong, the anime that this particular this Gundam is from. It's one of the very few in the series in Gundam Gundam anime there's absolutely no English dub whatsoever. But like I was saying, it's a difficult one to get into because it's one of those sort of earlier ones, and it just has a really slow start. It took a long time to kind of pick up and get going. It was okay once it did. I'm very much into the ones that I enjoy the most are sort of the shorter watches. Like, I really like Thunderbolt. The 8th MS. I like sort of the non-new type, you know, ones that are maybe a little grittier. Thunderbolt's excellent. Let me just scroll back here. I think I missed Mad Titan Tronos. He said, is airbrushing difficult to do correctly? No, it is not. I'm anti-weeb. I hate anime, but love Gunpla. You know, some of the Gundam light novels are pretty good too. Gundam Sentinel. That was a good light novel. I've been watching dubs longer than subs. Got started with Afternoon Toonami block, including Sailor Moon. Hey, cool. Well, there you go. I mean, some of the dubs are terrible. They're just terrible. And then, you know, some of my favorite anime doesn't have dubs. Light novels are a new, horrifying facet to my crippling book addiction. Yes. Yeah, some of my favorite anime do not actually have any dubs, and nor can they be. Like, you know, I mean, people kind of roll their eyes when I say it, but I'm a huge fan of the Monogatari series, like Bakke Monogatari and Monogatari episode, you know, series one, series two, the whole Monogatari series, all of it. I love it, and it would be absolutely impossible to dub. Because there's so much, there's the writing is so fast paced, and you know, it's just, it would be a difficult one to dub, and as such they're not even going to try. Best dub goes between Wing and G. I'm generally not a fan of the dubs because I don't care for American voice style acting. Yeah. Yeah, for Etchy Bat, for me, it's more just a convenience, you know? Like, if you're sitting there and watching anime, yes, I'll do the subs. But if I have it just on while I'm doing something else, I can't read subtitles while I'm concentrating on other things. I can't do that weird thing where you can make one eye kind of go off and look at something else while the other eye focuses on what you're doing. I've tried, but I just ended up with a headache. So what do you like about you know, Dishan, tell me what your take is on Wing and G being the best dubs. One of my new favorite feel good anime that don't have dubs is The Order of Rabbit. It's about these students who work in coffee, candy, and tea shops. Oh, cool. I like that anime trope too. I was excited to find out that there was a second season of The Devil is a Part-Timer coming on. I just thought that was really funny. Wing for Hero going, I'm going to kill you! And going, mission accomplished, when the mission is not accomplished! And G because, Master Asia! Fantastic. You know, I laugh too at that whole trope with Gundam of like, okay, how many times is the commander gonna just let the kids steal the Gundam, right? Let those two toddlers, barely out of toddler age, just take the giant war machine robot, right, and just go off in space. And he's like, you know, they rush in and they do the whole like, oh my God, you know, what's his face and what's his face? They've gone off in that. And the commander's like, whoa, those kids. You know what? No, I'll allow it. It's too funny. I don't remember. I'm going to have to go back and rewatch those now because of that D-Shen. Jaxif, I'm not native English, but basically I only watch dub. Jack is if. I'm gonna call you Jack. Welcome. And hi. Or you're not okay. You're not a native. You're not native English, but basically only watch dubs. I can't keep up with reading and watch what happens. I only see subs. The only series I watched sub was Death Note, and had to pause to keep up. Yeah, I find with Monogatari, I'm doing that a lot as well. Because it'll be just wall of text, wall of text, wall of text. And you're like, oh, fuck, all right, go back. In fact, I generally will only watch it on my computer so that I can do frame advance. Because there's all these, in between scenes, there's all this other text that they play from the books. Those have the best dubs, yeah. Well, the 8th MS and Iron Blooded were just well produced throughout. 8th MS is probably one of my favorites. It's in my top four favorite Gundam series. Mizuzuki feelings are strong. Wow, it's a lucky thing all these kids are expert Gundam pilots. I know, right? I'll allow it. And Dishan, I don't know if you've watched Thunderbolt, but that's another one that's way up there for me. right, what's next here? What's next? All right, we got some little tiny white pieces. Rolling up back in chat to Mad Titan, are you, so you build, have you considered doing airbrushing? Are you sort of thinking about that as something that you're going to start looking into? Because I'll find something to paint a little later on. I mean, I could in theory do this one backwards. The one that I started that I didn't have the paint for, I could paint it white. Oh, well, yeah. I mean, you're listing, D-Shen, you're listing all the classics there, right? Like, I mean, Cowboy Bebop had some amazing, amazing dubs. It's probably the single greatest anime ever. Outlaw Star, yes. Big O, yes. Trigun, yes. Ghost Stories. Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, yes. Space Dandy. Yeah, Bebop is just, I mean, it's kind of in its own place. Yes, Samurai Champloo. Absolutely. Jack, I haven't tried G-Paint yet. I've been meaning to pick some up. I'm out of Canada, and some of those paints are a little harder for me to get my hands on without importing them. For example, there is no distributor of Gaia Notes up here at all. So everything has to come in through the States. So I tend to just stick with what I can get locally, which right now is Mr. Color, Tamiya, the AK Interactive paints, these ones. They're a lacquer that I've actually are quite good. I just bought a couple as a test. What was that movie done by the company that did Samurai Champloo and Cowboy Bebop? Was it Redline? Was it called Redline? That insane racing one. That has a hilarious story too. Redline, yeah. The story behind that is pretty funny too, how they just kind of like it's so amazing. It's such an amazing show or a movie, but the ending is so abrupt. The ending is just like bam, done. We love you. Just found a shop.
Bring out your dead.
Here's one.
Ninepence.
I'm not dead.
What? Nothing. Here's your ninepence.
I'm sorry. Those. I need to change those. I apologize. Those are again from the Renfair stream. I just haven't gone into Streamlabs and changed those yet. It's very random. Very random. Why do you have Monty Python? Anyway, it doesn't matter. I just found a shop here in Nederland selling it. I'm going to get it today to try. Still learning to airbrush. Nice. I've heard good things about G-System Paint. I really have. And thank you for the follow. Thank you. Much appreciated. Just got that going. Focus. Everything always looks better after the decals are on. I will do a little bit of painting. I will do some airbrushing in a bit here for people. Just to show you it's easier than you think it is. All right, so we need this one like this. I really should have attached this to the other piece before I did this, but I didn't. There. One of my top five character intros in anime dub is Dead Man Wonderland, where Genkaku walks in and someone says, "Who the hell are you?" And Genkaku just says, "Dude, Uber Monk," and slays. D Shen Long, thank you so much for dropping by. Thank you for the follow. Enjoy the sub. Really nice of you to drop by. Check out the stream. Have yourself a great evening. Have yourself a great weekend. I'm back on here again tomorrow evening, same time. Cheers. We got those. Then let's just stick this guy on here, though, so that I don't have to... No, I did that on the wrong side. Classic. No worries. There are more of them. Let's do that one. How's the PC build coming along, Drift? I thought you were doing a Hackintosh. Did you change your mind there, or? Ah, yes, okay, yeah, yeah. So, I mean, I remember with Hackintosh is that there was always a lot of consideration you had to do with respect to what hardware you got. Is that still the case, or is it a little more roundly compatible with hardware? Like, I mean, you had to be really careful what hardware you bought. It's a lot easier these days. Oh, I found a clip of it. Second clip in. Okay, we'll check that out in a minute here, Dream. It's a lot easier these days, but you're more restricted on the GPU. I see, okay. Any tips on dry transfers? I seem to struggle with them. Do you mean decal decals? Like what I'm currently doing right now? I'm not sure what you mean by dry transfers. You can hack most newer hardware now, but newer NVIDIA GPUs because the drivers don't exist. Okay. Yeah. Too much liquid. That'll do. The one you press scratch on them. I have never seen those, Jack. I've only really ever used water slide decals and stick. Well, I mean, like stickers. I'm aware of how stickers work, but the ones you press and scratch on. I don't know if anyone else, if Driff or anyone else with some scale experience has used dry transfers and can provide any tips on that. But yeah, I apologize. I don't really. I've never used those. Yeah, like what kind of a kit would those be in, Jack? Yeah, that's the Drift. They do sound like they're a bit like that. Like, Jack, the easiest thing to do would be tell us what model are they in. Like, what did you get them in? Let me queue up that video. Just get Firefox open here for Drift's video. Not Drift, sorry, Dreamcatcher. So found a clip of it. It's the second clip in, so you can just see it and quit. Around what time, Dreamcatcher, should I cue this to? And let me look at that drift. After the Amazon ad. Okay, we'll watch it. We'll watch it in a minute. Yeah, this is interesting. I've never seen these.
Cover, how to apply dry transfer decals to your kit. What you'll need for this are a few things. Firstly, the piece of kit you want to apply it to. This is just the shield off a high-grade Zarku kit. I just grabbed it out of the bits box for this demonstration. Some masking tape. Bobby knife. Your decals. Now these generally come in many of the master grade kits, whereas the high grade kits will come with stickers. The master grade kits come with these dry transfer decals. Just for the sake of, should always be on the back. Cut out our decal. These sections here to put a little bit extra around.
Sorry, I'm impatient. Cut it out. 10 minutes to say cut them out. Kit.
Just chuck in the middle here for now. Take some masking tape. We need a couple of pieces. One either side. Oops. It's always best to have the two pieces of tape just so we can stick it down firmly. Now the reason behind this is because when you're going to rub, it's going to use a bit of you're going to use a bit of force, and it'll actually move the decal if it's not securely put down, and that can cause all sorts of ugly looking finishes. Yeah. So now that it's down, all we need to do is take our coin and just with a bit of force scratch away on top of the plastic. So now, as it's as you're doing it, you'll notice that the colour will actually change as it's getting transferred away from the plastic backing to the kit. It's a good way to tell actually where it actually is, it has come off and where it hasn't. So you just need to just keep doing that for a while until you get an even coverage. Now, before you go all crazy and take it and rip it all off, what I generally do is take, just peel back the bottom tape, hold on to the decal while you do this, peel back the tape so the bottom half is loose, and if you just lift plastic, you can actually check to see if the decal has come off fully.
Yeah, so what I will say is by keeping the one side of it taped and lifting it up like that, if for whatever reason he hasn't completely adhered all of the transfer, he could stick it back down and continue rubbing in the areas that it didn't adhere properly. So that might be one thing, Jack, just to keep in mind, is that like, it's almost like with offset printing, you know, you have the registration marks. You don't ever want to move the registration marks on your on your pieces, on your transfers out. You keep things exactly where they're supposed to be by keeping that one side taped down when you check it. So, I mean, I could see how that's an advantage and maybe something you should try doing. Because to me, what would be missing from this in terms of the workflow is you wouldn't really know if it was completely adhered properly until you try to remove the backing.
Yeah, if it, in this case it actually has, but if it hasn't, because of the top tape is still holding it down, you can just push it back down.
Yeah, which is what I just said. Yeah, yeah.
And then continue to rub with the coin. Rub back over with the coin, you get those last little bits, because sometimes you do it and it's like the corners get missed, or there's a little section where the little paint come off and it's a bit more force. So if you do it like this, you can actually check before you rip it all off and then have to try and reline it up. So it's always best to do that first. So now that it's we've checked it and it's all okay, you can just carefully just remove the tape and the plastic, and there we go.
That's yeah. It. Wow. Fiddly indeed. I've never seen those. That's completely new to me. I've never built a kit that uses dry transfers. I had no idea those even existed. Learned something new, Jack. The other thing I would say is you may be more thorough in terms of that process of adhering it if you used get yourself some some inexpensive sculpting tools. Some you can buy. I'll see if I can find some here on Amazon. You know, a set of tools like this, which you may or may not have already, depending on what you, what other hobbies you're involved in, might be easier and give you maybe a little more control than a coin. Insofar as scratching the back of it, just a thought, anyway. All right, got to watch this clip from Dreamcatcher.
What the fuck, fellas? Where's the albino?
Dude, Uber Monk.
You might want to think of a backup plan if you're waiting for Ace Man. Our lives are nothing more than suffering. Why hammer it into the kiddies' heads one at a time when you can teach them all at once?
Dude, Uber Monk. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that. You're very welcome, Jack. And yeah, those are frustrating. What I said, and you know, my tip on the stickers, and I don't know if Drift or Etchybat or anyone else who does a fair bit of Gunpla, my tip on stickers is don't bother. In some ways, your kits will look nicer if you don't even use the stickers, is my feeling on them. Because you just can't avoid the sticker stock is so thick, you just can't avoid always seeing the outline of that sticker transparency. Yeah, they always look kind of cheap, exactly, Etchy, if you really like, if there's a particular high grade that you are really interested in, or something that came with stickers that you want, you want to maybe do at a bit of a higher level, then what you should do is look for equivalent decals for that model. There's tons of decals available for you aftermarket in direct from Bandai. For most of the models, it's just a matter of finding ones that fit the particular kit that you're working on. But like sheets like this, right? with all of the Xeon symbols or the AUG or the FETI symbols, you can get these in abundance, and they're rather inexpensive. So that's what I would do. I use stickers on this kit because it's flat otherwise. Well, you may want to just look around online and see with some of your local Gunpla stores if they sell water slide transfers, water slide decals, decals to some, decals to others. Fordad, Frankenstein laughter. Yes, I may now be rather awake. For me, it's get the real thing, mainly flags. Yeah, it's the same kind of thing. With the stickers, I would probably look for equivalent decals, and they're always going to look better because water slides are so much thinner, like Etchybat said. You generally don't see the outline. You can only kind of see it as you change the light. You can kind of see the outline of it as I do that. But that will disappear. Generally, my process is I hit the whole model again with a clear coat, a gloss clear coat, and then I'll go over that with a matte coat. At least that's what I say that I do to finish my models, and then I just won't do that. I'll just put it on the shelf and I'll forget about it and move on to the next thing. All right, so let's keep doing a few more of these. Then I should really be able to paint something. I need to do the back of this one. You have water slides for your next MG kit? Yeah, you'll run out halfway through because you don't understand how much gloss you need. Yeah, you probably have that problem more than I do, for dads, but yes, exactly. Exactly. That's why it's sometimes... Actually, that's why I like the pledge, right? That's why I like the pledge stuff. Because it's so cheap. Now, you can't use it as a true gloss coat. You'll always get... I have not been able to find a way of using that pledge floor polish without getting some amount of orange peel. If anybody knows a secret to that, please let me know. But as far as just a gloss coat that you then matte coat over, it works just as well. And I mean, some people don't like water slides. They feel that they're hard to do. But once you kind of get your technique in, you see, you've probably all been following how I've been doing this. And, I've got that bead of water there. It's a little too much because the decal's sitting on the surface tension on top of it. But you just stick your Q-tip on the side to get rid of some of that liquid. and then you can position it a lot more easily. Just poking it around with a Q-tip, or sorry, a toothpick. And then once you have it roughly where you want it, I shouldn't say roughly, I should say exactly where you want it. You just roll over it with a Q-tip. Press all the water out from underneath. It's easy. Goth kit is dirt cheap. Second hand for €5. Nice. The OO Quant. I like looking them up when people post them because, like I said before, I'm not a Gunpla pro. That looks like a nice kit. Very nice. All right, where are we at here? Okay, so what I can do tonight with some of the airbrushing is I'll do the pieces that go in here. I haven't done those yet, so I'll do those. I just want to make sure there isn't photo etch that goes in those. Just get the instructions. If you have never done a resin kit or a resin conversion kit before, this is what you should expect for instructions. It's really just a parts list followed by a very rudimentary, like, put stuff here. There is this photo etch section here where we can just make sure that. So there's a piece of photo etch on the back, but nothing on the front, so we're okay there. So let me find those parts. It's not that, or that. These. You and you. Now, I have two different sizes of these. I can't remember which goes where. That must be back there. Ebs and I went to check the train store after the move into the larger premises. It was interesting to see that there is already an area being set aside for my matching area. Cool. Okay, so is that 27? Okay, so they do go in the back there. All right, so we can paint these orange. And so does that mean there is photo etch? So these big pieces of photo etch, I guess, go in there. One. Yeah. Interesting. Let's see if those actually fit. Because I don't trust that those fit. What it's saying is these pieces of etch. Fit in here. They do. Look at that. Perfectly. That makes life so much easier. Okay. So, do a little bit of airbrushing. What we're going to do is we're going to spray lacquer in this one. So this one, this piece goes in the front right here of these. Like that. So we're going to spray this in this chrome, which will just be the flat area on the inside. No photo etch on those. Then we're going to mask that and paint the rest of it orange. These ones can be painted entirely in orange. Only these pieces, these photo etch pieces, will do in the chrome. But before I do those in chrome, I need to stick them onto something so I can paint them. Usually I use a popsicle stick. Let me just grab one. And I should have some double-sided tape here somewhere in my amazing organizational system. See, I would argue that I would have I actually got that faster than somebody with an elaborate organizational system. Because they would have had to get up and go over to the tape section of the room and then go alphabetically through to double-sided, the D's, and then take that tape, come back here and use it. Whereas I simply shuffled through some shit over here and found it, right? Just saying. It's like she knows. It's like she knows I'm talking about her. With her perfect wall of glitter boxes or whatever the hell was in those things. It's 100% jealousy. It's 100% jealousy, Etchibat. And Drift, she completely threw you under the bus and basically said, Drift is even more organized. Like, I gotta show this. What was that in? Was that in chit chat? Cats, lots of cats, way too many cats. No, link picks. Let it out. No, it should have been in let it out. Promote Corvus Oculum. It was in your channel. Yes, it was in your channel. So Etchibat puts this in Discord. Okay. and then says, but Driff is way more organized than I am. I mean, does he have robots that get the stuff for him? Like, are there robots? Four dads, like, what? Yes. See, I have woken chat. I have awoken the chat kraken with this. Like, I don't even. But like, here's where it all falls apart. If you disorganized bastards out there like me have one thing, right? One thing we can relish. It's this area up here. Right, this ruins it. This ruins the whole thing. So, we at least have that going for us, folks. You have these in order of... Is this in order of, like, luminosity? If I make this black and white, will this be a perfect gray, like grayscale? Jesus. All right. You should see our shed. Where do you find the time is what I don't understand. I don't understand people like you too. Because where do you find the time? I don't have time to clean up my workshop because when I'm in it, I'm working in my workshop. And I'm not trying to sound offensive in any way if it comes across that way. It's pure, unadulterated jealousy is what this is. Makes you me feel like organization. Four dads, you have no idea. It literally looks. I made the joke on our Discord that my workshop looks like someone cracked the door, pulled the pin, chucked in the grenade, closed it, braced, boom, opened the door. That's what mine looks like. No, Etchybat. You don't give me that. Like, you see my background. I've got shit all over the island behind me. No. The island behind you looks like, yeah, maybe you left a few papers and things out a little bit, right? Like, you have no idea what I'm surrounded by right now. There's a reason it's in tight on my face. It's not because I'm a handsome man. It's because you can't see the rest of my shame. So that's what it looks like. I do. As long as you know where things are, exactly, and I know where everything is, except for the rest of my German gray paint. Anyway, everyone else in chat's like, "What the fuck are they talking about? How do we get onto this?" I like the jars too, all the jars. Where she walked into a store and said, "These are lovely jars. I will need 130 of them." There's like 80. There's got to be 80 to 100 jars there. Yeah. I will need 140 of these, please. I'm sorry, ma'am. We only have 120. I am leaving the store now. You have failed me. All right. Let's paint. Container fetish. Well, we have these other 20 to fill in the rest of them, but they have a slightly different lid. No, I am leaving now. I'll be knocking over a display on the way out. Okay, so those bins on the wall, I drove all around Las Vegas to multiple locations over the course of several weeks to get the same container. You have issues. You don't have issues. You don't have issues, Etchy. You're perfect. You're perfect. Never change, okay? How many jars do you want, miss? Miss, yes. I will take all of the jars. Okay, so for these pieces, we're using Alclad lacquer. And I don't actually need to do those. I need these smaller ones. Now, Alclad lacquer, you don't thin. Just it's airbrush ready. Just getting that inside piece, that flat area, and these.
Unpredictable artist has entered chat, and this is her badass introduction.
Unpredictable artist, welcome. Welcome, welcome. We were just talking about you, only good things. She's awoken. It has risen.
How are you doing, Unpredictable? I haven't seen you around for a few days. It's almost like you took some kind of long form of sleep after the Ren Fair. Like you closed the blinds and kind of just laid low for a while, regained your strength. Just teasing. I was just teasing when I said only good things. You did, in fact, sleep a lot. Yeah, you missed the bit where I, myself and Drift single-handedly took credit for all the successes of the Ren Faire. Because you weren't here to defend it. That happened. I jest. Though it was a lot easier than last Ren Faire. Awesome. It was fantastic. I had a lot of fun doing that. I think everybody did. It was a great idea. And I can't thank you enough for introducing me to that. It's very enjoyable. Yeah, it was a great idea. It's a great idea. Drift can take all the credit they want as soon as they actually join the Ren Faire. Well, I was in the Ren Faire. I actually kind of made that up. It was actually just me. I took all the credit. Well, I'm glad to hear it. You missed that earlier. You missed the Ren Faire version. Only dropped off the train a few times. Oh, like the raid train? Because that thing just kept going. All right. What have we got going here? So these guys have to be orange, and I actually have orange. See? Proof. Yes, it was excellent. It was excellent. Is there anything that you would have done differently? Couple connection issues? Yeah. Yeah. Well, Etchy's actually got a little weird little lag thing at the end there. I've noticed that a few times on your stream, to be honest with you, Etchybat, where your audio is fine, but it's like your frame rate drops to nothing. You need 10 more heralds and them all to be as good as Etchybat. Well, I mean, I would have volunteered, but again, it's that may have backfired fabulously. Yeah, you say your stats are all fine. You use Streamlabs, don't you? Do you get a... I wonder where it is. Is it this one? Yeah. In Streamlabs, do you get this information? Oh, you do use OBS. Okay, sorry. For some reason, I thought you used Streamlabs. So I answered you answered my question. I mean, the only issues that I noticed on mine is like, just to kind of give you an example of how, like, OBS isn't a good, it's kind of a crappy judge of what's really happening, is my, like, when someone redeems, oops, what the hell happened there? When someone redeems a Tape God thing on mine, and all that motion starts happening, I don't get any drop frames. I my computer runs fine. Like, I see the Tape God video play really quite well. But when I watch it back in a VOD, it just turns to absolute potato quality. Like, you know, the worst Ukrainian peasant field potato quality potato of potato quality. And it's but yet my stats are fine, right? But it's just the whatever crazy re-encoding that's happening on it's peasant field potato quality. It's like these potatoes are inedible in every respect, yet there is some starch and therefore we can make vodka with them. But yeah, it's like they're just garbage. It's just the quality of the VOD when that happens. I mean, it's probably what you guys see when it plays. Know that it's not meant to look like that, but it's just terrible. Yet I don't really get any. MC Killer. I love this part in Monty Python. Big raid. Welcome, Heresy Killer. Welcome, welcome. Welcome, Raiders. Hey. Welcome, Heresy Killer. How was your stream? Thank you for the raid, and welcome. Stream was rad. Awesome. That's fantastic. We are currently working on a Gundam Double Zeta resin conversion kit. Right here. Very stylish robot. Giant sexy robot. Did some decals earlier, and we're currently doing a little bit of painting. Did a piece fall off? What fell off? Doesn't matter. Oh, from the back. Weird. I don't know. Went camera left. Oh, yeah. That actually wasn't even attached. It was just sitting up there. It's this little doodad. Stream was rad. Talked with Warlander. Ah, Warlander. One of my fellow British Columbian compatriots from the Great White North. He's really far up north, though. Like, almost in the Yukon, northern British Columbia. That gentleman is an amazing tabletop terrain builder, par exemplaire. He is an armless robot currently. However, we have quite a lot of the arm pieces done. Unpredictable. We've got these done. It's really coming along nicely. The arms. So we were doing a lot of the decals earlier. Now we're going to do a little bit more airbrushing and finish up a few pieces. But But yeah. Hey, Etchy Bat, thank you so much for dropping in. Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure. You go and get some rest. I know you've been working really hard at having a vacation. And I'll be back on, as you know, tomorrow night at the same time. But yeah, so Heresy Killer, what have you been building? What were you working on? Take care. Big hearts. Big hearts. And Etchybat, thank you for the or no, it wasn't you. I'm sorry. I take those thanks back. They are undeserved. They're not. You're so generous. But Driff is the one who donated the gift, who gifted the sub to Dishenlong. But thank you so much. She doesn't get credit. I'm sorry, Driff. I came really... You know what? I'm gonna go with Etchybat for this one, Driff. I'm sorry. Etchybat, thank you again. Sleep well. Sleep well. You should record the Tape God Renfair edition, okay? And then you can play that as a little lullaby. Just to lull you to sleep. Vin Hobby Spot, welcome, welcome. May have bought all the stock of camera arms in the Australian warehouse. Alright, let's get this orange on here. Let's get this orange paint on here. So for this, we're just going to paint these pieces. Actually, no, let's not do that yet. Getting a little ahead of myself. We need to mask these first. Which shouldn't take too long. Are getting dull. Silver and Fantasy Designs. I feel it necessary to wait for the actual stream alert to end. I love it. Every time I love it. Silver and Fantasy Designs, welcome, and thank you so much for the raid. Hello, raiders. How are you all doing? Silver and Fantasy Design, of course, an amazing artist, does some fantastic jewelry and other things with resin. Let me find your button here. Silver and Fantasy Design, there's a shout out for you. If you haven't already, do give Heresy as well as Silver and Fantasy Design a follow. Follows are free, follows are for friends. And how was your stream? How did things go? What were you working on? Links are open, by the way, if you have some work or something that you want to show off in chat, please feel free to post it. But keep it clean. Darn, I hate these dry transfers, but just a couple more to go. You're getting there. You're getting there. Scratch that a little bit, but that's okay. It's the only thing with using the Salcloud lacquer is it's pretty fragile. It's pretty fragile paint. So Raiders, we are currently working on this kit. Let me just get this stuff out of the way here. We are currently working on building a resin conversion kit for the Gundam Double Zeta Bandai product, which looks like this here, when it's done. So a resin conversion kit, for those who don't know, is essentially it's a stock model that's had a whole bunch of extra aftermarket improved parts added to it, which gives it a ton more detail. Just makes it makes your boring vanilla robots much more sexy. But we're currently working on that. I'm sort of at the home stretch of this particular project. I've been saying that for, I think, a month and a half. Etchybat's been keeping track. She's gone. But it's essentially, I've got the arms done. We've applied a bunch of decals to it right now. And we're at the point where we're just sort of basically doing the last little bits and little touches, little tiny touches. So how big is it? Let's see here. If I get the camera there. So it's difficult to gauge the size, but you've got that. That's basically it. So it's maybe about, I would say probably about 25 centimeters tall. Thanks, Darth. It's a 1/100 scale Gunpla model to begin with. But Silver and Stream was great, working on a beachy heart with ocean waves made with resin. Awesome. And is that like is it like a necklace, or is it a desk piece or a tabletop piece? Good night, darlings. Gonna get some stretches. Gonna do some stretches to wake up. Dreamcatcher, as always, thank you so much, my friend, for dropping by. Always a pleasure having you here. Take care. I'll be back on tomorrow evening. If you're around, love to have you. Unpredictable. Decals. She's making fun of me. Sometimes I say decals. Sometimes I say decals. Goose night to you as well, Dreamcatcher. I made a 6-inch tall death scythe once, not nearly as nice as this. Yeah, well, that's the thing with resin conversion kits, is they tend to add a lot more detail, and they just make everything look a lot nicer. Imagine those MG and real grade pieces that you've seen people scribe, do all these amazing scribe lines and things to add all that extra specialness to them. With resin conversion kits, you're basically buying that. I used a wood heart. It's just adorable. It's about 9 inches by 9 inches. Did you post a link to it? How does Unpredictable know it's adorable? Were you watching? But I want to see now. I feel left out. That's all right.
So we got those. So now what we need to do is we need to paint all of these orange. So let's get these on some, now that we have these inside pieces masked. You saying decals is adorable. That's true. I am adorable. Though I'm sure Silver's work is adorable too. Yeah, we haven't. The consensus is still out, as far as I'm concerned, on whether it's decal or decal. I think it's still a very national thing. I mean, this is a... I mean, Four Dads, you're down in the land of backwards toilets that spin anti-clockwise. What do you all say there? Sorry, I was just wrapping up after the stream. This is what I was working on. Oof. That's awesome. So you're doing the same sort of stuff as Warlander. That's amazing. So this is like a... It's like a Japanese... style estate house type thing? As tabletop? Did you do all of, like, everything that we see here? Is this all you? We say it both ways as well. This is really good. This is super cool. That's awesome. Oh, I'm not logged in on this account. I'll do that after. Awesome work, my friend. And thank you for sharing. But last night I was actually working on that. Oh, wow! We were just talking about the 8th. There's a few people here who,
Bring out your dead!
Here's one!
Ninepence.
I'm not dead!
What? Nothing. Here's your ninepence.
We actually had, I actually was a participant in the streamers Renfair, last weekend, and all of my stream alerts are still Renfair kind of edition. They're not normally parts of Monty Python, the Holy Grail, but they are until I change them. There are a few of us who are just talking about how amazing the 8th MS is in terms of just a good old-fashioned romp through Gundam, Gunpla, no non-new type fun and death. Now, when you mention it's a goof custom, what are you doing to it that's different? Sorry, I had resin dye on my fingers. The walls are custom meeples. And the vending machine and Jennery are Reaper. A few 3D... Oh, very cool. Okay. That notification, yeah. I may just leave the alerts. What the hell, eh? Okay, let's look at this. Another link. Wow. Really good. I am so impressed with just the quality of the tabletop terrain streamers. You know, Warlander, yourself. And here's the custom goof, okay. Oh, okay, so it's actually, the kit is called the Goof Custom. Okay. Apologies, I thought you were doing some custom work on it. Like subscribing or something like that. That's awesome.
I did keep the Ren Mor tape. You're right, Four Dads. That's the kid's name. I understand that now. I am slow. Wow. Again. Always impressed, Silvern. Always impressed. It's so good. Super talented. Super talented. Thank you for sharing that, everybody. Yeah, isn't it? It's amazing. First time doing that? Like what? Doing the ocean texturing? Or... Really, because this is my first time doing terrain, I mainly do minis and other stuff. I'm going to do more 3D models on Monday, pinstriping on Tuesday. Very cool. Doing the waves on a flat plane, well, it really worked well. Looks great. What sort of tape do the Raiders want? Unpredictable's taking a call out for what version of the more tape bit. You choose, but I'm waiting to... I'm not going to paint until you hit the button if you're going to, because it just shoots me back over to this scene. It's a good choice. Lords and ladies, buckleth thou uppeth, for 'tis I who shall regale thee with the ode of the Tape God. Unpredictable, you're banned. Vermont is not best.
There are some references in there to Renfair-related things, of course. That was a throwback to last weekend when we were participating in the stream Renfair. It was a bit of a hit, so we left it in. Corvus, what did you do for your Renfair stream? Did you work on Gunpla? Of course, I did. I have nothing Renfair related that I can offer, but I was asked to participate nonetheless. great job. Yeah, I know more of these words than the original Greensleeves, that's for sure. Kits, we need resin kits. This was last week's pinstriping I did. Kind of happy how it came out. The class project I finally did came in useful. Let's see here. Oops, I can't do it on that one. Log in. Firefox always logs me out of,
Tape for the tape god. More resin for the resin throne. More sprues for the sprues lord. More paint for the paint king.
Dads, you rascal. That's the original. You'll be happy to note it does not potato out on the phone stream. Oh, good to know. I mean, the joke for anybody wondering what the hell's going on is when you're building resin kits, you use a lot of tape for masking. This ball represents all of the tape used in just this one kit, right? And I mean, it's just got some gravity, as we say up here in Canada. So this skookum is frig ball of tape, it's got some gravity in her. So our little homage, the little, you know, more tape for the tape god. Thank you for the redeem. Always fun. You know, I think we need this. Jack, have fun at the shop. Get yourself some resin kits. Get yourself some more sprues. Get yourself some more paint. Get yourself some water slide decals. and some G Systems paint. Thanks for dropping by. Welcome to the family here, and thank you for the follow earlier on. Take care. I'm back on same time, same place tomorrow night. I stream on Wednesdays, Fridays, and Saturday nights. You'll be happy to note it does not potato out on the phone. I read that already. That's the first time I'd seen it. As an auto body repair guy, I know the pain slash zen-like joy of taping stuff off for painting. Exactly. Exactly. It is very cathartic. Also, like, especially with these with highly three-dimensional pieces like what I'm doing, deciding kind of what the strategy is to paint them, right? You know, what color should be done first and then masking it off from there. So now that all of that tape god stuff is out of the way, let's go and paint these. So we're using Mr. Color Lacquer, and we're going to thin that as a 1-to-1 ratio with Mr. Color Rapid Thinner, which gives us a matte finish. Put the lid. There it is. And we'll just mix that in the pipette. I'm using a Harder and Steenbeck airbrush. It's my main airbrush, dual action, 0.2 millimeter needle, and it's the Infinity brush from Harder and Steenbeck. Orange is always a difficult color to airbrush. It really should be going on over a yellow or a white primer, but in the interest of time, we're just going over gray. And I think I say it every time I do airbrushing, but a reminder to not let off the air. Keep the air always running. Even though you stop the paint, I'm still pressing down. And then it avoids any splatters. Little pro tip. Little pro airbrush tip. That'll do. Now, there's quite a bit of orange still in there, so I'm going to just put it back in here. That's waste not, want not. Give this a bit of a clean. I apologize, I don't have my other phone set up, so I can't really see chat from here. I'll catch up when I'm back. I just use regular hardware store lacquer thinner for cleaning. Give it a little spray. After back feeding it with the finger over the end, I just wick out the majority of the paint, empty it out into the pot. A little more lacquer thinner. One more round. Empty that out. It's a really good habit to get into, is just cleaning it after every color switch, just clean it. I also make a point of always disconnecting it, because tripping over your airbrush hose and throwing your $300, $400 paintbrush across the room is a bad idea. Bora, welcome. How are you, my friend? I hope you're doing well. Let's see here. Catch up on some things. Unpredictable. Have yourself a wonderful sleep. Thanks for dropping in. I'm glad to see that you've got your sleep schedule back on track. And thank you for the points redeems and all the fun, as always. Just realized my soldering helping hand also makes a good document holder. Yes. Yeah, take care, unpredictable. Apart from being at work, I'm great. How are you? I'm sorry to hear you're at work. Okay, so what we have are these pieces done. Now, the other nice thing, because I paint with lacquers, they dry almost instantly. See, that's already dry after having painted it. I can easily handle it, no problem at all. No need to worry. And these ones have a bit of tape in them, so we're just going to pull that out. Focus. Are you at work? Are you just starting work, Bora, or are you finishing up? Out. That's perfect. Just want to give Bora a little shout out there as well. An amazing mini painter. I only know how to pronounce the first half of his Twitch name. But always does impressive, very impressive busts and figures and dioramas. He does it all. And, of course, unpredictable artist. Now that she's gone, I'll shout her out. Because otherwise it would just go right to her head. I tease. Unpredictable is an art streamer, as well as she does some game streaming. But mainly art. Fiber arts, as well as some painting. Heresy, don't tell me what I can't show off. How dare you? Let's have a look, everyone. I don't have to show this off. I've already shared enough, but this is one of my first mostly airbrushed minis. Actually did the blue in Candy Technique. So it gives a shiny blue like a car. So by Candy Technique, you use like a chrome base coat and then a transparent blue on top of that? Yeah, nice. I have a, I'll see if I can find it, but I'm going to be doing a Sazabi. In I'm going to be doing a Sazabi in that. It's got some, the spoon's a bit scratched and damaged, but that is that technique is basically like it was a gloss black, then dryer sheet with the chrome sprayed through the dryer sheet, and then the Alclad Candy Red on top of it. But I'll be doing a Sazabi in that. My latest project, the wife has already stolen it. Oh, here's an example of some of Bora's fine work. Thank you, Darth. Too good. Is that another printed mini? Yeah, it does. It reminds me of Alita from Transformers as well. Yeah. Super good. I still think of your monk. The monk that you did was just like, wow. All right, so let's deal with these. This is the other little trick. If you're dealing with little tiny parts like this in resin kits, often if you've done garage kits and resin kits, you know, usually you pin pieces together with brass rod, but what you'll find with resin conversions is the parts are too small to do that. So what I do is I just crazy glue, you know, with like Bob Smith Industries cyanoacrylate glue. I just glue toothpicks to them, and then what you can do is you can just snap them off really easy. And that's how I spray them. It's just easier to deal with them. Then if there's a bit of residue left, you can just scrape it with an X-Acto. After I did the paint, I found I just painted her like Sister's Chroma from Transformers. Nice. Yeah, it did did come out really well. So these pieces, let's get them in. We can just put them in. They go right in here. That. So let's get some glue in there. Don't need much. And what I'll do is I'm just going to take a little bit of blue tack pick it up with that and set it in so it's centered with the blue tack. Perfect. Silver and Fantasy, always a pleasure having you. Thank you so much for dropping in and bringing your crew. Thank you for the raid. Have yourself a wonderful weekend. I'll be here tomorrow, same time, same place. Take care. Thanks again. Big love. Thanks if it wasn't for me taking photo really quick to show it off. I would take a photo in daylight. The Turbo Dork and Candy work well. Work better in that kind of light. Yes, yes, that's very true. Good night, Silverin. Take care. Take care. Always fun. And hey, amazing work on that heart, on that sea heart. Let's get this one in there. Whoops. That's no good. There. It's as easy as that. Cool. Then while those are setting up, let's get these pieces in here. Let's actually do it on camera, though. So these are our photo etch pieces. They're metal that just add some extra detail to an otherwise boring kit or part, and I'll install them exactly the same way with a little bit of blue tack. On the end of a toothpick. And just put a little tiny bit. Actually, I'll do it this way, because I don't want so much in there that it oozes up the sides. So we'll just put it on a piece of tape here, and then we'll just do this. Got to get it closer to the end. Just need a little tiny bit. We'll pick one of these up. And stick it in. And then we'll do the same thing on this guy. Those dry for a minute while we get rid of this. We don't ruin something. All right. And then we'll just get these in here. Fail. There we go. Perfect. So we'll get some panel liner in there, but not tonight. Because I need to hit it with a clear coat before I do that, and it'll bring that extra detail out. You see all of these, all of these parts, they've had panel liner, get these dark lines, just to give it a little more depth. But yeah, it's really coming together. I'll do a little more tomorrow during the day, and sort of hopefully my plan, everybody, is to actually finish this completely by the end of tomorrow's stream. I'm calling it. I'm done with this. The double Zeta can be something for the shelf after tomorrow. Let's see. Also, I need to go and get more paint, which I'll be doing tomorrow as well as buying steaks for Mother's Day. Don't forget it's Mother's Day on Sunday. If that is relevant to you. The next project, let me just load it up here, is going to be a Calamity Schnabel Gun full resin kit. So that will be starting next Wednesday. I'm hoping the timing actually works out well if I can finish up the double Zeta tomorrow, because that'll give me a few solid days of time to get all of the resin pieces for this prepared and ready for painting, because I don't really want to do resin cleanup and sanding on stream too much. I don't really have a good facility to provide entertainment while doing that kind of work, because I need to wear a respirator when I do that. But yeah, this is from Luca Zampriolo, original sculpt. It's a 1:44 scale. I think it's around 120 pieces, maybe less. But we're going to weather the fuck out of it, to borrow a phrase from our dear Etchibat, and probably do it similar in terms of its overall paint job to this, only green is what I'm thinking. You can tell certainly with Luca's sculpts that it is very, he does borrow a lot from the Gundam sort of universe. I always see bits like these here, right? I think I have a Sinanju that has exactly the same parts on my shelf. But yeah, his kits are all basically scratch built, kit bash scratch built, put together that way, and then he casts the pieces as masters and sells them in small batches for far too much money. But we're gonna be starting that hopefully on Wednesday. I'll have the pieces all primed and we can start pinning. The first stages will be pinning it and getting the pose that we want. And then moving forward from there. This one is going to have a lot of hand painting. All of the stuff that you see here and underneath and these sort of machine parts, they all have to be hand painted, but that's going to be done probably in acrylics. And then just a lot of washes and grime and pigments. We're going to be showing everybody how to do like hairspray chipping. As well as, I don't know if I'll do salt chipping, but I'll do hairspray chipping for sure. We might play around with the AK Interactive chipping fluids a little bit on it. But yeah, it's going to be a good one. Drift, I'm not really sure. Like, what we'll do is we'll work that out on stream because I'm open to suggestions. You are somewhat limited in terms of the poses. He does give you a little bit of a joint kind of geometry to play with, but you can't do anything nearly as dynamic as what you would see in Gunpla. But we'll figure something out. Once we kind of have a lay of the land for it, we will definitely open it up to suggestions. If somebody has an image of something that they like, I'll also do a vision board like what you see here. Like what you see here, but with far more versions of the Schnabel gun. The Schnabel gun, fortunately, is one of Luca's most early kits, and so there are a ton of examples out there on Pinterest, Instagram, everywhere of other people who have done the Schnabel gun. So we got lots of ideas we can work from. So that's I had a poll as far as what we do next between the Napalm Inferno IMS 5-star series kit, the MRSA Kshatriya, I don't know how to pronounce it. This is a full resin kit. I'm kind of glad you guys didn't pick this one. This one would have been brutal. The Gasness Temple, I think it was the Gasness Temple, and I have a Gundam. This is the Blue Duel resin conversion was another option, and the good old Evangelion Eve 2 suit, which was just going to be a straight assemble and paint, a quickie, so to speak. And you guys all picked the Schnabel gun, so. Excellent taste, my friends. Excellent taste. But that is it, I think, for me tonight, everybody. I hope I have entertained the masses as sufficiently as possible. It's been fun as always. Let's see if we can't find someone to raid and someone interesting to take everyone over to. Yeah, just even busier than normal day with the missus. For me, it means work. That's every custom kit. You're absolutely right. And yeah, maybe a side by side with the AK versus hairspray. I have done those, and I do have commentary, but we'll wait until Wednesday or later when we actually use the product, and I'll tell you what I think. I'll give you the deets. I'll give you the deets, because Four Dads, you probably don't do a lot of like real hardcore grime core diesel punk type weathering, I would imagine, but it's fun and interesting to do, and you guys I think will learn a lot from it, because it's not as hard as people think. So let's see who else is on here. Do Zulamandi? Yeah, powders and chalks. That's kind of what I figured. Maybe extreme moderation. Doing some miniature painting, so let's head over there. And again, thank you, everybody. Thank you, Silvern, for the raid. Thank you, Heresy Killer, of course, for the raid as well. Jack, thank you for the follow. Etchibat, thank you for the Dost Thee Have More Tape redeem. Driff, thank you, sir. Thank you again for the kindness of gifting Dishen the sub. And, of course, redeeming the More Tape for the Tape God. White Wolf, thank you for the follow. Taka Cage, thank you for the follow. And Teal, thank you for the follow. All right, everybody, let me just set up this raid. Have yourself a great weekend. Have yourself a great Saturday. I'll be back on here, same place, as I said before. Same place, same time, tomorrow night. See everyone. Stick around for the raid. Show some love. Show some love. That's the expression I want. And we'll see you around. Great chatting. Absolutely. Always a great bunch. All right, everybody. Enjoy your weekend. More tape for the tape god.